Welcome back to Wildcard Workshop. Now today, we're going to start working on a full project. Now if you remember our Dino Shrine before, that wasn't so much a full project as much as sort of a prototype, a learning experience, which is fine to do. There's no problem with going out, trying out a feature, seeing how it works, but if you want to work with a full structured project, you want to really dig into an idea, there are a number of things that you should do when you're really digging into a project. And we're going to cover the first of those today, which is a design document. Now, if you're familiar with design documents and you're already comfortable with doing this, you can probably skip this video. Now, what your design document is it your scope? If you don't have a design document, it's really easy to not so much forget, but lose sight of what the objective of your mod was. And if you do that, what happens is you end up with a disjointed project. A lot of people might play it, but at the same time, it's not really as polished as it could be. And some of those features maybe would be better served in their own mod, where they can excel a lot better as well. So the first task is to make our design document for our virtual Sentry system. So we're not gonna touch the dev kit again today. So we're gonna pop over to my desktop. And we're gonna take a look at the design document that I wrote up, and I'm gonna go over everything in it and where things will change probably as we move forward with our project. So we're going to be starting out with a whole new project. So we might as well start by creating our version control for it. So I've already gone to GitLab and logged in, and I've selected to start a new project. I've already filed in the information. We've got virtual Sentry system arc mod. I've given it a custom project slug just for the sake of easy naming. A description, set the visibility level to internal. Basically anybody who's logged into GitLab will be able to download this and fork it or anything of the sort. And then I've told it to initialize the repository with a README. Since this is a fresh project, we don't have any files yet for it. This is perfectly fine. Let's go ahead and create project. Oops, I made an error. Let's fix that. Error fixed. Create project. And there we go. Let's go ahead and open up GitLab. If you're signed into GitLab within Gitkraken, if you're signed into Gitkraken with your GitLab account, you should be able to see all of your projects here. So we'll select the one that we just created. We'll tell it where to install it, which will be in the mods folder, and then clone the repo. And go to open new. You'll see we've got our README here, which has just that little bit that we put in for the description, which that is going to get overridden in a moment. And the reason is because I have written up a design document. So let me get that really quick and move that into the repository. So now, if we look at the new readme.md, and what MD stands for is markdown. Basically, that just means that there's a formatting option available to this plain text file. You'll see how that works in a little bit. It'll show up on the actual GitLab page with some formatting. Here we are at the focus of this video, which is the design document. Now, if you're familiar with design documents and how to make them and all of that fun stuff, then you can probably skip this video, as I mentioned before. But I do want to reiterate that it is important to do this if you're working on a serious project. And the reason for that is because we want to define the scope. We don't want our mod to fall victim to scope creep, which it is very easy to do, since with mods, generally we're working with smaller subsections of a game, and then we get a great idea and we're like, oh, we should put that in the mod too. And it just doesn't actually mix well with it. So what a design document allows us to do is define that scope, define the features that we're looking for, and allows us to keep a consistent experience across the mod. So let's go ahead and take a look at it. Ignore the red lines. Those are what it was expecting from the original. That's what it was removed, quote unquote. So what we're looking at it are these green lines. These are everything that's been added. So we got virtual Sentry System mod. Mod design document. Overview. These are just headers. So the first thing is questions. These are the questions to ask yourself when you're making the mod. What is the mod? Feature mod that adds a new form of area defense using temporary creatures to access sentries in a localized area. Why create it? To offer an alternative means of base defense for both online and offline protection that is not absolute but still substantial. So the goal of this is, as opposed to mods like Orp, which are an absolute defense system, that structures can't be damaged at all, we have an option that can be bypassed by offline raiding, but it'd be difficult. In fact, it'll probably be difficult while with regular online raiding too. But it is more substantial than just having your creatures running around on Wander, undirected, uncontrolled. So what is the primary focus? Primary focus is that players can take creatures that they've tamed and raised and, you know, put a bunch of effort into. They can sacrifice them as templates for these sentry creatures. Now, these sentry creatures are temporary, which means they get spawned and despawned. So even if they're killed, they're not gone forever. They're only gone forever if the sentry crystal is destroyed. Okay, which would mean destroying the tower and all of that. So they're pretty well protected in those scenarios. What are the win conditions? Now, normally, so these next two questions, what are the win conditions, what are the lose conditions? These are more for if you're working on something of a more substantial mod. But I was able to sort of answer these questions within the context of this mod. However, if you're working on something more like a complicated game mode, it may be more appropriate to expand on these being actual win conditions for the player. In this case, I've kind of put it under conditions of what is considered winning and losing for the sentry system itself. So for the win conditions, basically the sentry creatures kill or fend off attacking enemies from a specific area. The lose conditions are that all sentry creatures are destroyed or the sentry tower is destroyed. So those are the two objectives, what wants to be avoided and what we want to achieve. Now we have a list of features. Feature 1, the player can train up their own creatures to desired specifications to be sentries. Okay, this is the process of virtualization that can be sacrificed to make those sentry crystals. Feature 2, artifacts can be used during the virtualization process to result in bonuses for the sentry creature that was created in it. Maybe like extra levels or maybe some extra stat points. We'll figure that out as we go. Not everything needs to be detailed in this. Okay, especially with mods, because a lot of the time we don't necessarily know what we're wanting to do is actually possible. So we can leave a little bit undecided. We can specify objectives of what we want to do and then work out the specifics towards those objectives later on. But this document will define a plan. And that's what you want. You want a plan. So aside from artifacts being used on the sentry creatures themselves during their virtualization process, we can also unpack artifacts to find augment crystals, which can be used to provide bonuses to actual tower functions, such as the cooldown time if all the creatures are destroyed, the amount of time between when it can start spawning them again, or potentially other things. We'll figure that as we go. We can see what we might be able to put augments in later on, but we will do one in augment system. So the way the sentry towers will work is they'll spawn virtual versions of the creatures that were sacrificed that will attack anything designated as an enemy within the range of the tower. Now the range of the tower, I'm still deciding on how that's going to be determined. It might be determined by the height of the tower, how many segments and modules it has, Maybe by augment crystals. We'll figure that out later. If the sentry is destroyed, it'll be respawned after a designated period of time. And when we say the sentry, I mean all the sentries. So the way that this is currently planned is that that cooldown doesn't take effect unless all of the creatures are destroyed. But it won't spawn new creatures while an attack is in effect. So basically, the process here will be enemies enter the range, the tower will spawn all of the creatures. Enemies will have to fight them all down, but the creatures won't be respawned as this is going on. So there will be an opportunity that enemies can defeat everything, but if they leave the area, the tower will despawn, it'll dematerialize all of the creatures, and they return to their state before the battle, which means if the enemy enters the area again, all of the creatures come back immediately. So they have to stay within the range of the tower and fight off all the creatures. If they leave, they have to start all over. If they manage to destroy all of the creatures, the tower is disabled for a little while, and then they have free reign to do what they want. Whether that be destroy the tower, if they can manage to do it within that amount of time, or go ransack some vaults. So here we come down to the details section. Now the details section right now is just sort of the structures and items that we have set up. The details will probably be expanded as we go. So the overview of the details. Players will need to build a virtualization station to start. The station will have several pedestals around the outside that allow for placement of artifacts. After placing a single creature in the station, it can then be sacrificed for virtualization. I am going to fix these typos before I actually upload this. Or before I commit this file change. The creature's stats and information will be stored into the crystal item that can be attached to sentry towers. The sentry towers can house multiple crystals depending on how tall the tower is built. If the tower detects enemies within its range, it will spawn all of the installed virtual crystal all of the installed virtual sentries to attack. If all enemies in range are dead or have fled the area, then the tower will despawn all the creatures. If all of the virtual sentries are defeated, then the tower will shut down for a little while where it cannot respawn sentries. Artifacts can also be unpacked to get augment crystals for the sentry towers. These can give bonuses like reduction to cooldown if creatures are destroyed. So that's pretty much just a reiteration of everything that we already talked about, but this is spelled out in the file now. So the structures and items that we're going to use, these are basically mirrored at the moment, because all of these items are going to be primal item structures. So we've got the virtualization station base. We have the virtualization station artifact pedestals. And this may not actually have an item. We'll figure that out as we go. But at first, we'll probably set up it as an item. But then maybe down the road, we'll just make it automatically add these pedestals. And we have the sentry tower base. The sentry tower base is going to be important because this is going to be the actual control nerve for the entire sentry tower. Each of these segments, the sentry module and augment modules, are going to basically be the data housing. So the tower base will communicate with all of the linked sentry tower segments and pull data from them about augments and the particular sentry crystals. The sentry crystals and augment crystals will be attached as structures to the actual segments. And then we just have that mirrored down here at the bottom. Because, at least at first, all of these are going to have primal items to allow for the placement of the structures. So this is our starting plan, our design document for the mod. In the next video, we will start probably setting up these base structures and the items. We're going to start off setting up our framework for the mod based on our plan, and then we're going to move on to implementing the specific bits and bobs of functionality and features that go along with it. Okay, so I've fixed my typos, And I think we are ready to commit our new design document. So we'll stage the file, give it a commit message, commit changes to one file. And then we'll go ahead and push it. And now we go to the main page on GitLab. What we'll find is here is our design document. Now I would put the link down below for this project if you want to download it. Not a whole lot in here right now. We'll start adding more as we continue along on these episodes of this project. You can also potentially fork the project to have your own copy of it on GitLab in your own project space, allowing you to make your own changes to it. Also, I almost forgot. I am going to initialize Gitflow on this project, and then I am going to push the develop branch to GitLab as well. That way we can keep the version in master being the one that goes up publicly on the workshop, and the one that we continue to work on will be on the develop branch. So there we are, all set up for our project. We'll be ready to go in the next episode. So now that we've got our design document, in the next video we're going to actually pop back into the dev kit finally, and we're going to start setting up some of these base items and structures and start building out sort of the framework of what's going to be there. And then as we continue on, we're going to start adding on the additional functionality for these items and adding the polish and putting in the visual effects and adding in the meshes. So stay tuned for the next video. And as always, happy modding.